she was Cindy. Always had a smile, loved people, loved to do things for people, loved cats, wanted to be a career woman. She wanted to live in the city by the ocean. She wanted to live close to the, she loved the ocean. That was her most thing she talked about all the time. That night, well, I thought she'd come home. And John got up and went to work, and then I got up a little bit later, and I was working part-time. And I got up to go to work, and I had looked in her room, and I thought, oh, wow, she made her bed before she left. Well, but she didn't. I went to work, and then he was driving.
I went by the cemetery. I was going to go up to Comanche and look at a job, because that's what I do, you know, construction work. And I seen her car there, and I pulled in there, and her purse is sitting neatly in the back of the seat, and it's locked. And I come back, and I said, isn't Cindy supposed to be at work? So she said, so yeah. So I called her work, and she says, no, Cindy never showed up. So then that's when we started, and we did a missing.
Called the sheriffs.
And it took a long time to.
First sheriffs didn't want to do anything, or they said because she's an adult.
It has to be adult, and it has to be over 24 hours.
72.
Or said whatever it is, but we finally raised so much cane and everything that they got on it, and it became quite a search. We had this whole valley was I was really overwhelmed how much they cared and how they helped. And we had searches on horses. I mean,
airplanes.
I've had helicopter rides. I mean,
boats.
Planes and boats. I mean, it was just amazing how the community all came together.
We live in a wonderful community.
And we pressured him so bad and found out so much, that's how they got arrested. He was just a punk kid that wanted everybody to be afraid of him, and with his t-shirts and his tattoos. And he just act, you know, just how they act, you know. And he did, that doesn't bother me. You know, you get 15 years ago, well, I was pretty young too. I heard him talk to his friends there about how him and Shermantine killed a guy up there in Hope Valley. And I didn't even realize it until they brought it up in the trial. And I told Chastity, I said, well, I heard him say that in the bar. I'm feeling disgust with our legal system for letting him out. Now, what's going to happen? Who's he going to kill next when he gets out? I have watched and read in the papers and everything. I haven't seen any serial killer or any serial rapist or anything that didn't get out and do it again. I mean, I'd like to know what the percentage is, but I bet it's about 99 to 1%. And he's no different. Him and Shermantine have been killing since they were 18 years old, and they've gotten away with it. He's been in prison for 12 years. That doesn't make you a good guy. That doesn't reform you. And now he's out. He beat the system. He's got it, like Tom Testa said. He's gotten away with murder. It's not only me, but it's the whole county. San Joaquin County does not want him here. And he should not be out of the streets. He's a serial killer. He was convicted of 3 first-degree murders. I keep saying that over and over, and he didn't. He's not out because he's innocent. He's out because of a technicality that the appellate court overseen that didn't do their homework. And I keep saying that because of the fact I watched and listened to hours and hours of the questionings that they've had. He had cigarette breaks, he had Coke breaks or drink breaks, he had sandwich. And the only one time in the whole situation that I seen, he did not ask for an attorney. He said, well, he told the investigating officer, he says, maybe I should get an attorney. Maybe I should get an attorney. To me, that doesn't mean he asked for an attorney. He waived his rights when he went ahead and kept talking.
You don't think that every morning, every day you wake up, you think about your daughter, child, whether it's your daughter or your son, whoever it may have been. I wouldn't wish this upon my worst enemy. I wouldn't even wish them losing a daughter like we have on them. It's very hard. And then in the paper today it says, well, he's still married. He's going to go. His kids are waiting.
What about
he gets to go home to his family. How come I don't get my daughter? They won't even tell me where she's at so I can bring her home. Explain that one. So what justice is that? What right? Why should he have Why? I don't understand that.
He's just guilty. So.
I mean,
You never forget. That's something you never do.
We'll never forget. There's a day goes by, we don't think about her.
Yeah.
Her birthday, I always go buy a present. It's usually something that I knew she would like. It's usually jewelry or something. And I'm keeping it for her. Christmas, we always remember her. Our family, we talk about her when we're all together and stuff. And that keeps her memory. Her memory is very alive. If you go on Facebook, you'll see there's a lot of, we have a lot of support on her, on the Facebook. I mean, family and friends. And I don't want a shrine. I don't want anything like that. I just want her home. I mean, he gets to go home. How come I can't have my daughter?